Right now, all over the planet, something pretty revolutionary is happening to the way we produce and distribute electricity. For most of the last century or so, flicking a light switch or putting a plug into a wall socket has provided an instant flow of electrons that had been generated just milliseconds earlier at some giant power plant somewhere far away that most of us knew very little about, and frankly cared about even less. After all, we're busy people, right? We just want instant power on demand. But that centralised monopolistic power generation model is now being completely upended as public awareness of planet warming greenhouse gases grows, the cost of wind turbines, solar panels and battery energy storage plummets, and consumers like you and I are becoming far more conscious of the need for energy efficiency. The future of energy is now being shaped by groundbreaking digital innovation, and arguably one of the most profoundly transformational of those technologies is the virtual power plant, or VPP. So what exactly are VPPs and how do they work, and why are they about to completely disrupt the way we generate, store and distribute electricity? Hello and welcome to Just Have a Think. Before we get stuck in, I just wanted to give a shout out and a huge thank you to the almost 3,000 folks who support me each month via Patreon. As you may or may not know, when I first started the channel back in 2017, I took the decision to never monetize any of my videos via YouTube, which means those videos never get interrupted by annoying ads. I also chose never to accept paid sponsorships or partnerships either, which means you never have to listen to me pause in the middle of a video to tell you about the latest widget that I apparently think you should be buying. And that freedom allows me to be completely independent in my reporting without any external influence or financial coercion. And none of that would be possible without a group of like-minded individuals scattered around the world who feel that the channel's content is worth at least the price of a coffee each month. Those folks have my eternal gratitude, and of course they get exclusive monthly perks as members of the Just Have a Think Patreon platform as well. So if you'd like to join them and help us reach that 3,000 member milestone, then click the link above or in the description section below to visit patreon.com/justhaveathink to get a very warm and heartfelt personal welcome from me. Right, virtual power plants. Why are they a thing then? And how are they going to upset the energy apple cart? Well, like all new technologies that stand any chance of being successful, VPPs have to address a real and demonstrable problem or deficiency in the current system. When it comes to energy, I think most of us know what those problems and deficiencies are, don't we? The traditional, very large, centralised power generating facilities running on coal, gas, nuclear or hydroelectric produce electricity that has to be transmitted across vast networks of power lines to reach homes and businesses. And that's a horribly inefficient model, vulnerable to large-scale outages if anything goes wrong. And although nuclear and hydro are in the mix, and in some parts of the world even represent the majority of supply, at a global level, the sector is still dominated by fossil fuels pumping ever-increasing quantities of carbon dioxide, methane and other greenhouse gases into our atmosphere. The antithesis of large centralised power generation is the concept of distributed energy resources, or DERs. These are, by definition, smaller decentralised sources of power generation and storage, like wind turbines or your rooftop solar panels and home battery systems. So DERs offer incredible potential for clean, localised energy production. But because they're all over the place, they do represent something of a challenge when it comes to coordinating what are already thousands, and will before long be millions, of small energy resources to act as a single cohesive unit. And that's where virtual power plants come into play. They work because digital connectivity has reached the stage where cloud-based networks can seamlessly connect them all together and aggregate them so that they effectively function like a single power plant. Using advanced software and real-time data, a VPP can monitor, control, and optimize the energy output of each resource, providing power to the grid when needed and reducing demand when supply is low. And that matters a lot, because as our grids take on an ever-increasing proportion of intermittent generation from wind and solar, having millions of small smart devices all over the place allows grid operators to smooth out spikes in grid frequency and keep the lights on without us end users noticing any difference to the service we receive or the usability of those devices. Cloud control software continuously monitors the energy production and consumption of wind turbines, solar panels, home energy storage systems, electric vehicle batteries, and even smart appliances like water heaters. When the grid needs more power, the VPP controller draws a little bit of energy from available devices. And then when there's excess renewable energy being generated, the controller can dump some of those electrons back into things like batteries and water heaters to charge them up again. A VPP can also control things like smart thermostats that regulate air conditioning units. In warmer climates, that offers a huge benefit to energy suppliers and energy consumers. Instead of the usual massive surge in demand on very hot days that can be extremely challenging for grid operators to cope with, a VPP can tell a smart thermostat to turn the AC on during off-peak hours to get a home or office nice and cool before the peak demand kicks in. That staggers the cooling times across the day and smooths out those abrupt demand spikes. In extreme conditions like heat waves or cold snaps, a VPP can really pay dividends with an almost instant dispatch of that stored energy or instant dumping when there's an unexpected and rapid overgeneration that might otherwise fry the network. The tech bods call it demand response, and it's a crucial tool for maintaining grid reliability. And of course, folks like you and me are offered incentives in the form of lower electricity bills to take part in the program. The owners of the Distributed Energy Resources, or DERs, love it too because they get an additional revenue stream by selling excess energy back into the grid from their solar farms or wind turbines that might otherwise have to be periodically shut down or curtailed at great expense. And you know, if you've got one or two concerns about our warming climate, then virtual power plants offer a major contribution to tackling that challenge as well by maximising the use of clean renewable energy and reducing the need for fossil fuel-based power generation. So when are we going to see these things in reality then? Well, they're already happening in countries all over the world, aren't they? Here in the UK, Britain's largest electricity supplier, Octopus Energy, already operates the country's largest virtual power plant, encompassing more than 1.5 gigawatts of utility-scale battery energy storage systems and electric vehicle batteries, offering overnight off-peak tariffs that save car drivers an average of almost £800 a year, and providing grid flexibility for all of its customers. Over in Germany, the Next Kraftwerk project represents one of Europe's largest VPPs, aggregating thousands of small-scale renewable energy producers across the continent, including biogas plants, wind turbines and solar panels, into a single VPP that trades power on the daily market and maximises profitability by collecting and merging operational data from the VPP itself with current weather and grid data and live market data, all via their clever algorithms. Then there's the South Australia virtual power plant, which is perhaps the best known of all VPPs, thanks to Tesla's heavy involvement right from its inception. From a starting point of an initial 129 megawatt hour big battery at the Hornsdale Power Reserve back in 2017, it's now grown into one of the largest VPP projects in the world, connecting thousands of homes equipped with rooftop solar panels and Tesla Powerwall batteries. A little further north, China is of course a major exponent of this emerging technology, with several gigawatts worth of virtual power plant capacity playing a major role in that country's efforts to modernise its power grid and transition to a more decentralised, flexible and intelligent energy system in line with the overall goal of reducing carbon emissions, increasing energy efficiency and ensuring energy security. In the United States, companies like Sunrun and Tesla are pioneering VPP initiatives that allow homeowners with solar and battery systems to participate in energy markets. According to the US Department of Energy, VPP capacity in that country currently stands at somewhere between 30 and 60 gigawatts, or about 4 to 8% of national peak electricity demand. Still a relatively small proportion, but growing quickly in states like Vermont, via Green Mountain Power's $10,500 incentive for domestic consumers, in Massachusetts, where National Grid, Eversource and Cape Light Compact have a joint VPP initiative that rewards customers for allowing the utility to control their domestic battery storage systems, and Colorado, where the state's largest utility company, Xcel Energy, is in the final stages of rolling out a statewide VPP network. It's not all roses in the garden though, there are one or two caveats. Unsurprisingly, given what we've learnt in various earlier videos on this channel, one of the biggest challenges is the shaking up and modernising of antiquated regulatory frameworks that are stuck in the old mindset of centralised monopolies and are struggling to catch up to the rapid pace of technological advancement. And of course, the behemoth incumbent utilities, backed by their lobbyists and fully funded political sympathisers, are not at all keen to see their empires being systematically dismantled. So there are usually some pretty tricky policy barriers and legal challenges to overcome. Arguably a more rational concern is cybersecurity though. After all, the whole distributed energy concept is predicated on shared digital platforms and real-time data. That makes these systems potentially vulnerable to cyber attacks. That's a game of cat and mouse, of course, that already exists in our globally connected electronic world, and VPP technology will be no different. Last but by no means least, VPP technology is just bloody complicated. Integrating a wide variety of distributed energy sources that all have their own characteristics and capabilities into one seamless operation is a massive challenge that requires some extremely robust data analytics, super advanced algorithms, and very sophisticated control systems. But human beings are smart, aren't they? At least technically speaking, anyway. And achieving all those things is now well within our gift. Systems like the Kraken data management software, devised and developed by Greg Jackson and his team at Octopus, who I mentioned earlier, are already well established. Kraken processes more than 3 billion data points each day here in the UK, and the company now operates a system for service providers in 18 different countries around the world. So I think it's fair to say that the future of virtual power plants looks very bright indeed. As technology continues to advance at breathtaking pace, regulatory frameworks finally get with the program, and of course the urgency of our climate predicament increases, VPPs really will become a vital and indispensable component of our energy systems, enabling more resilient, more efficient, and more sustainable grids. If you're involved in this exciting new frontier, then it'd be great to hear your views on the challenges and opportunities you face in your daily work, or perhaps you just have views about how our global energy systems are evolving that you'd like to share. Either way, the place to leave your thoughts is in the comments section below, and I'll be very interested to hear what you've got to say. That's it for this week though. Thanks again to the folks at Patreon. Don't forget to jump over to patreon.com/justhaveathink to have a look at all the exclusive perks you can enjoy there. And if you found this video useful and informative, then you can hugely support us and help us get to that 600,000 subscriber mark by hitting the free subscribe button on YouTube. Doesn't cost a penny to do that, and it's just a simple click away, either down there somewhere or on that icon there. As always, thanks very much for watching. Have a great week, and remember to just have a think. See you next week.